Hello. My name is Alicia Archibald, and I'm on the Pumps and Systems editorial team, and I'd like to welcome you to today's webinar, Vertical Pumps Below the Surface. This event is sponsored by Sulzer and will be led by Sulzer's Seth Tate. Before I introduce Seth, I wanted to remind you that we will have a question and answer session at the end of the presentation. You can submit a question or comment at any time on the chat feature on the lower left-hand side of your screen. The webinar is being recorded, and it will be replayed tomorrow at 7 a.m. Central and 9 p.m. Central Time, and it will be available to view at pumpsandsystems.com/webinars starting early next week, and it will remain there as part of our archived webinar offerings as well as with our numerous white papers. And now I'd like to introduce our presenter, Seth Tate. Seth is a technical advisor with Sulzer. He has 15 years of experience in equipment, maintenance, and reliability. He's an expert in providing technical direction, supervision, and repair training, troubleshooting challenges of rotating equipment maintenance and repair, and delivering economically justified long-term solutions. He's going to be joined by other people from the team, and I'm sure that you're really going to enjoy it. It's a great presentation. I want to thank Sulzer again, and again, welcome each of you. And with that, I'll turn it over to Seth.
Thank you, Alicia. Welcome, everyone, to our latest webcast. Sincere thank you to Pumps and Systems for such a great platform in interacting with our rotating equipment colleagues. You know, vertical pump technology, it's a vague topic, and today we'd like to focus our time about discussing reliability and design, and then this unique vibration issues that persist in vertical suspended pumps. I'm Seth Tate. I work for Sulzer as a retrofit specialist and technical advisor. It's a great pleasure to be able to bring this panel of experts together today in pumping technology. So a sincere welcome to Marcus and Bob, and welcome Elvis and Dan.
Hello.
Hello, everyone.
Hello, everyone.
Marcus, would you be willing to start us off and tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Hello, everyone. My name is Marcus Souza. I'm the Advanced Engineering Manager for Vertical Pumps with Sulzer Pumps. I have 25 years of experience in the pumping industry, and nowadays I'm globally responsible for the selection and application of the vertical pumps.
Hi, everyone. Bob Davis here. I have over 40 years in the business, 30-plus years with Johnson Sulzer Vertical Pumps. My focus has been pump engineering, both in design and in the test bed. I've tried to retire several times, but I'm still here at Sulzer helping with the engineering growth in vertical pumps.
Hello again, ladies and gents. My name is Elvis Nitifon, and I work for Sulzer as a simulation tool developer. My role entails creating custom software tools with the purpose of automating finite element analysis and computer-aided design work. Now let's see, I joined Sulzer in 2012 and have a combined industry experience of 12 years.
Hello everyone, my name is Dan Bond. I've been designing and re-engineering pumps for the past 30 odd years. Currently I manage a very talented team of hydraulic engineers whose focus it is to support both new equipment and retrofit equipment with customizing hydraulic designs to meet our customers' unique performance requirements.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, for those of you that don't already know, Sulzer has a YouTube channel with well over 100 informative videos like today's webcast. You know, please take a moment after the event today to subscribe and stay up to date with our latest videos. And many of you may be involved or simply interested in remote and continuous monitoring of your pump system health. You know, this topic has been a front runner of most corporations, and machine learning has finally found a place in our industry. Again, for those of you interested, there are some great webcasts about advanced analytics on Sulzer's YouTube channel, or you can also visit Sulzer's Blue Box webpage for more information. So how about we jump into today's topic, you know, vertical pumps and their application from a reliability perspective. You know, Marcus, I knew there were some options on vertical pump design, but I was not fully aware of how many there are to choose from. In the sea of all these options, how do you get it right? I mean, it looks like there's some opportunity to be wrong when choosing a pump for a particular application.
That's a very good question. That's correct, Seth. As you can see, there are plenty of options when you are designing and engineering a vertical pump. So a reliable pump starts with a good selection from the portfolio. Wider the portfolio, better the chance to find a unique solution. So we are often given the hydraulics and some form of design criteria, but these are not what keep a pump from being a reliable and economical viable machine. It's more often the things that are not discussed, like operation excursions, solvent installations, and things like that, which becomes a nightmare for the user and engineering team. If you notice the construction of a horizontal pump versus a bow assembly on a vertical pump, I would say there is a lot going on from the bow to the pump flange. As these vertical pumps can be very long machine, so friction, unroll, and head losses play a really significant role on the overall pump performance and the life of the equipment. In the vertical pump world, the flow, head, and PSH available are not enough to select a good and reliable machine. Although there are still important parameters for a pump selection, we also need to consider the type of machine and its own requirement. Dan, would you have anything to add here?
Yes, Marcus, I would. In the world of vertical pumps, there is no such thing as a pump book performance curve. Only bowl performance can be cataloged. The hydraulic performance for every vertical pump build must be individually calculated based on the pump's unique mechanical design configuration. Compounding the influences of the mechanical configuration, the site installation details, particularly sump design for VS1 pumps and can design for VS6 pumps, have a critical impact on the in-situ pump hydraulic and mechanical performance. Using a race car analogy, think of the hydraulics as the engine and the mechanical assembly as the chassis. The overall performance of the car will be determined by both the engine and the chassis, both of which need to be custom configured based on the details of the racetrack or the customer system that the car is intended to race on.
Yeah, that's a really good analogy, Dan, about the complexities of a pumping system. We can all appreciate the vulnerability of a poorly designed car, but Bob, I'm curious then, what are some of the issues that persist in vertical pump design?
Well, Seth, I'm a big racing fan, and I appreciate that analogy that Dan gave. But I want you to look at the picture on the left and notice the TBH curve, which stands for total bowl head, which is a performance of just the bowl assembly and not the entire pump. This is a unique part of vertical pumps in which the length of the pump, the low liquid level, and the discharge design all play a part in what the overall pump performance ends up being. These have to be accounted for when purchasing the pump and should be reevaluated if you're having reliability issues with an old pump. Sump applications can have plenty of problems if the low liquid level isn't factored into the design. The sump has to keep a level in the tank high enough not to cavitate and tear up the pump. Not considering this means either poor pump reliability or mad operators from all the starts and stops since they have to keep an arbitrarily high liquid level. Not to mention how problematic vortices can be to the performance and reliability.
Yeah, these vortices, I've seen this, and they are very tough to diagnose, and especially if this installation is 19 years old and you have contextual reasons of thinking that everything is still good because of when it was installed it was good. Dan, what if I'm replacing an old pump with newer technology then, either to improve performance and efficiency or to improve, like, service reliability? Can we expect to be concerned about the old pump installation?
Indeed, Seth. The importance of good sump design for VS1 pump installations cannot be overstated. Determining the fluid dynamic details of the sump flow and their interaction and impact on the pump performance is probably one of the most difficult challenges there is in vertical pump hydraulics. Construction costs are always driving sump designs to be as small and as simple as possible. The complexity of the resultant sump flow field created by the flow interaction with the various sump elements, things like intakes, plunge walls, trash rakes, etc., is apparent from the sump CFD streamline plot shown on this graphic. Quantifying the magnitude of these flow structures and assessing their impact on pump performance can only be made through detailed CFD evaluations or model sump testing. The time and cost of making these investigations is minimal compared to the potential consequences of leaving them out.
Yeah, I totally agree, Dan. The sumper intake design plays a significant role on VS1 applications. So vertices can suck air into the pump suction and then can harm the operation and the pump itself. So in order to avoid vertices creation, such as surface, wall, and floor vertices, a pump engineering team like ourselves provide the customer with a technical support and guidance based on a sump physical model test or on a CFD analysis that will come with the design parameters for the new sumps or even remediations for the retrofit applications where the sumps already exist.
Yeah, these are all good points. It seems very tough to decide when a sump CFD analysis is actually needed, but, you know, I suspect you guys can help me decide this. I know there's many vertical pumps that don't use a sump tank but instead use a suction canister. Since this suction canister is a part of the pump package, what are some of the important reliability takeaways for a canister pump, for a can pump?
That's a very good question, Seth. Can pump has its own challenges, you know. A manufacturer of suction can should strictly follow ASME, API, and HI guidelines. So, not doing so, it's a risk of the hydraulic reliability, and more importantly, also the pressure containment safety, you know. That means that all the parameters considered on the design of the machine, such as wall thicknesses, local velocities, are following the guidelines and the design by rule standards.
Also, most of the time, the customer will have space limitations on his retrofit pump. If we can't meet the customer's retrofit requirements using industry standards, then methods such as computational fluid dynamics and finite element analysis are used to make sure we can make design adjustments to the can or the pump configuration to avoid creating other problems.
Yeah, that's correct. Thanks for the addition, Bob. Well, let's take an example of a can pump for a hydrocarbon application. So, After we just finished the pure hydraulic selection process, based on flow, head, any passage available, etc., the next step is to size the pressure containment components. So, designing a reliable pump requires sizing the can length for the entire allowable operation region. That means considering the worst any passage required condition on the entire curve, and not only the rated condition as we see sometimes. In addition to that, following velocity guidelines is crucial for a reliable pump. In some cases, due to the increase of the thickness of the can or the column pipe, the velocities can exceed the limits. And in this case, a bigger can diameter may be needed. Or sometimes, the losses get too high, impairing the pump performance. Then a new hydraulic has to be selected. This is where a large product portfolio and the engineering expertise come to place. For example, in general, we're going to have two or three good candidates for each selection we're working on. Would anyone like to add something here, guys?
Yeah, Marcus, I would like to insert something here. I see many applications where the customer wants to replace an existing pump but continue to use the same suction can. It has been my experience that we can either rebowl with new custom hydraulics or replace the entire pump with new technology without much more than a data sheet and GA drawing. But we get into trouble here when the retrofit involves higher flows. Higher flows mean higher velocities in the can to where we exceed Hydraulic Institute standards. This is where computational fluid dynamics can come in handy.
One would think that with the depth of Sulzer's hydraulic range coverage, there would never be a need to design new hydraulics. However, the reality is new hydraulic performances are routinely required. There are two primary reasons why this is so. First, market pressures continuously drive application requirements towards smaller sizes with higher energy density. And secondly, the perpetual need to retrofit pre-existing installations with hard physical constraints. Either way, the Sulzer hydraulic team is up for the challenge. What Sulzer brings to the market in this regard is the cumulative experience of almost 200 years of uninterrupted centrifugal pump innovation and design expertise. The depth of proprietary empirical data, as well as the pioneering spirit of technical innovation supported by some of the most advanced model test development laboratories and advanced analytical tools and methods, gives Sulzer hydraulic design teams an unprecedented foundational basis from which to create new bespoke performances.
Thanks, guys. Very good comments. Just want to make another quick note on the hydraulic. So it's common nowadays to have pumps operate on a VFD, so the pumps can respond smoothly to any fluctuation in demand, keeping the pump at a better position in relation to its own BEP and resulting in a better overall hydraulic performance and, of course, lower life cycle costs. However, it's also important to note that the vertical pumps in general are very flexible machines. That means they present a natural frequency that is really close or below a pump operating speed. The risk of the situation is then when the VFD lowers or raises the speed of the vertical pump for the new operation condition, there is a chance that the speed matches a structural natural frequency. In this case, could result in a resonance condition.
Yeah, thank you, guys. Very good information. You know, though we've hit on some of the key hydraulic concerns in vertically suspended pumps, you know, I think some of the most important takeaways that I got out of this is to be long-winded and to follow some recognized and, you know, generally accepted good engineering practices, you know, such as API 610 and boiler pressure vessel code. As we move on to our next topic, please keep in mind that you can ask your questions in the comments section so we can address them at the end of this discussion. Well, let's move on to vibration. Let's wrap our minds around that. Elvis, haven't heard from you yet. It seems like we are constantly battling vibration on vertical pumps. Can you tell us why this is the case?
Yeah, thanks, Seth. So vibration on vertical pumps is the result of the phenomena that Marcus mentioned known as resonance. And a few examples of everyday resonance can be experienced when we play on a swing set, for instance, or vibration of nearby equipment in response to loud music, or when we turn our car knobs to tune to our favorite radio station, or even the way in which a microwave heats up our food. In order to understand resonance, there are two dynamic properties that we need to look at. The first is natural frequency, which is the frequency where the structure vibrates freely if stricken with a hammer, for instance. It should be noted that all flexible structures have many natural frequencies with an associated mode shape of vibration, as seen here in the case of a vertical pump. And this leads us into the second dynamic property, which is mode shape. Mode shape is the physical manifestation that a system assumes when vibrating at its natural frequency. As you can see here from left to right, mode shapes of vibration vary with forms ranging from bending to drumming to twisting to axial displacements. So we've looked at the two main properties associated with resonance, which are natural frequency and mode shape. Now let's talk about resonance itself. In essence, when a pump is operating, a rotating unbalanced force is generated by the rotating assembly and loads the stationary structure through the bearings. And the frequency at which the unbalanced force loads the structure is the operating speed of the pump. Now, if a natural frequency of the pump matches the operating speed at which the rotating unbalanced force is loading the system, the result is resonance, and the pump can experience excessive vibration. Take the highlighted example. When a VFD is used to dial the pump's operating speed to 660 RPM, as the speed approaches the pump's natural frequency of 673 cycles per minute, which is quite close to 660 RPM, notice that there's a spike in the vibration amplitude as shown on the chart. Let's expand on this example with the analogy of a washing machine. As you've no doubt noticed in washing machines, especially the old ones, vibration increases significantly when a machine enters its spin cycle. The same phenomena is observed when ramping up a pump to its operating speed or while using a VFD. The red markers shown on the three charts represent three different speeds of the pump, and these are similar to the wash, rinse, and spin cycles of a washing machine. Notice that when operating at speeds of the left and right markers, vibration is negligible due to the absence of a natural frequency at those speeds. However, operating at the speed of the middle marker results in elevated vibration levels due to the presence of a natural frequency which causes a resonance condition. The amplified vibration level at that resonance condition is similar to what happens when your washing machine enters its spin cycle with elevated vibration and noise.
So then what you're saying is that bad resonance vibration occurs when the pump's operating speed is close to the natural frequency of any given component or a system of components. Then can I just design or re-engineer the pump's natural frequency far away from the operating speed? I mean, it sounds simple.
Yes, Seth. So avoiding resonance is indeed as simple as designing natural frequencies far away from excitation frequencies. But the process of getting there is far from simple. It's worth mentioning that although the focus of our discussion will be unbalanced excitation, which is the most common source of vibration in vertical pumps, there are other excitation mechanisms like bearing stability, misalignment, vane paths, vortex streets, and broadband excitation. Dan, before we proceed, can you talk briefly about a couple of these excitation mechanisms from a hydraulic standpoint?
Yes, Elvis, you've highlighted the two key aspects of mechanical vibration. One, structural response, either in the form of resonance or force vibration, and two, excitation sources. While some of the dominant excitation sources in vertical pumps are mechanical in origin, unbalanced and misalignment, for example, hydraulic excitation sources are also present. If we consider, for example, vane path hydraulic excitation, while this excitation source is always present, it is not always of sufficient magnitude to be of concern. However, if vane path vibration is of concern, then in addition to mitigation through structural design considerations, we also have the option of mitigation by hydraulic design options. The most effective way to do this may be to change the excitation frequency by changing the vane count of either the impeller or the bowl or both. Alternately, through the judicious application of impeller and bowl vane profiling, as well as control of operating clearances, the magnitude of the hydrodynamic vane path excitation forces can be significantly reduced. Early on, Marcus talked extensively on the topic of good hydraulic selection and ensuring operation stays within the approved operating region of the pump. We all know customer system requirements will invariably change over time. The unavoidable consequence is that pump operation may be pushed outside the allowable operating region limit into either low flow regions where detrimental flow recirculation develops within the hydraulic passages of the pump, or high flow regions where the pump can become NPSH limited and excessive cavitation develops on the inlet stage. Both of these operating scenarios represent conditions where broadband or wide frequency content hydrodynamic excitation forces develop with corresponding elevated structural vibrations. Mitigating vibration from these sources should always be accomplished by hydraulic re-rate, as the hydraulic phenomenon generating these vibrations are the result of poor hydraulic fit and not an indication of a structural design deficiency.
Okay, so then I definitely stand corrected. This can easily become a complicated design change. You know, I know that we provide advanced engineering analysis around, you know, vibration, as you fellows have described here. But Elvis, would you take some time and describe and look behind the curtain here and show us how does this really work?
Sure, Seth. In general, design calculations are either predominantly designed by rule or designed by analysis. And I say predominantly because in some cases, it can actually be a combination of both. With design by rule, the engineering of the pump is based on rudimentary equations. While this method is simple to execute, it tends to yield inaccurate results when calculating structural natural frequencies. Design by analysis, on the other hand, is based on a precise method to model the physical reality. It typically employs the finite element method and is far more effective for calculating natural frequencies in mode shapes of vertical pumps. And so at Sulzer, all structural natural frequency calculations use the design by analysis approach for both new as well as existing equipment when re-engineering is required. Once structural natural frequencies have been calculated, they're plotted on what we refer to as separation diagrams, as shown here. Natural frequencies are plotted as blue points, and the resonant frequency range to be avoided is plotted as a red line. If natural frequencies intersect with the resonant frequency range, then the design is deemed at risk of high vibration.
Now, that's an excellent explanation, Elvis. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. We've also noticed an increase in the use of VFDs in the last few years. Would you mind describing some of the vibration challenges and considerations for VFD operations, you know, VFD-operated pumps?
Certainly, Seth. Let's use a real case study to discuss how wider VFD ranges can increase the possibility of vibration. So back in 2015, we designed a pump for one of our customers intended to operate at a constant speed of about 900 RPM. The natural frequency results are plotted on the highlighted separation diagram that you can see here. And as you can see, the natural frequencies represented by the blue points fall outside of the resonant frequency range, which is represented by the red line. As discussed earlier, the intersection of the natural frequency with the red range would be an indication of the possibility of high vibration. But for single speed operation, the design was deemed safe. Then in 2018, the customer requested that the design be reevaluated for operation with a VFD from 700 to 900 RPM. And as you can see in the second separation diagram, which is now highlighted, the design fails with the wider operating speed range. This, incidentally, is why you would not want to simply install a VFD and expect your pump to operate as it did in time past. For correcting the above-grade mode, in this case with insufficient separation margin, there are basically two options. Raise the natural frequency to 18 Hz or lower it to 9 Hz. Raising the natural frequency is generally accomplished by making the design stiffer, while lowering is accomplished by making the design more flexible or by the addition of mass. In this case, it would be easier to lower the natural frequency from about 12 to 9, a 3 Hz difference, as opposed to raising it from 12 to 18, a 6 Hz difference. However, lowering the natural frequency is generally not desirable because that might introduce other failures such as buckling, and that needs to be very carefully evaluated.
And so if I understand you correctly then, this example means that the above-grade bending mode is a reason for failure if they install a VFD. I noticed that you have the first and second below grade modes shown on the sides of this graphic, and they are not the reason for failure. Is this typically the case, that the below grade modes are not a problem?
This is a very good observation, Seth, and this is certainly not typical, and below grade modes are not something that should be entirely neglected. So the below-grade natural frequencies are mostly influenced by the size and column, the size of the column pipe as well as its total length. When we deal with VFD operation, we typically expect to encounter at least one below-grade mode with insufficient separation margin. And one of the most effective methods for correcting below-grade modes is to modify the size and thickness of the column pipe. However, hydraulic requirements and the flow continuity law limit how much of a change is technically feasible. If we make a change that causes fluid velocities to exceed the limits, as discussed by Marcus and Bob earlier, then hydraulic performance suffers.
Thank you again, Elvis. This is a great example and certainly helps me realize the importance of your expertise. You know, there's something that I noticed we haven't brought up yet, you know, something that is also very seemingly important, and that's the motor. How does the motor, you know, affect pump vibration on these vertically suspended pumps?
Indeed, Seth. So the motor's design is perhaps the biggest challenge when dealing with VFD operation. Earlier, I made the statement that it's more desirable to raise the natural frequency by increasing stiffness in order to avoid inadvertently introducing other failures such as buckling. However, increasing the complete system natural frequency is limited by the motor's natural frequency. Shift your focus for a moment to the highlighted illustration. Here we have a representation of a vertical motor and its support structure modeled as a series of mechanical springs. The physics of combining these springs yields an equivalent stiffness, which is always less than the stiffness of the most flexible component. The implication of this law is quite significant. To use an analogy, just as a chain is only as strong as its weakest link, a pump system is only as stiff as its most flexible component. It means that the support structure could theoretically be made infinitely stiff, and the natural frequency of the combined system would never exceed that of the motors. And since pump suppliers typically cannot modify the motor's design, this limitation presents a rather difficult challenge. To illustrate, let's examine an example for another case study here with VFD operation. So here we have natural frequencies and mode shapes of the motor and its support structure. As you can see, although the support structure has a natural frequency of 56 Hz in the first highlighted image, which is more than double that of the motor at 22 Hz in the second image, when the two are coupled, its equivalent natural frequency of 10.2 Hz is only about half that of the motor's. Now, if this design were for constant speed operation, as shown on the highlighted separation diagram, then we'd have a safe design with plenty of separation margin away from resonant frequencies. Throw in a VFD to this design, and the design fails. In order to raise the natural frequency to a safe value, we would need to go up to 24 Hz. However, with the motor's natural frequency of 22 Hz and physical law limitations, this design can only theoretically get up as high as 22 Hz. And this can be seen in the chart where increasing the support structure stiffness results in a combined natural frequency asymptotically approaching the motor's limit of 22 Hz, represented by the orange line. And the closer the design gets to the 22 Hz value, the more drastic the design modification needed in order to raise that natural frequency. This leaves us with the only option of lowering the natural frequency, and doing so in this particular instance proved to be a design that was unsafe for buckling.
So then you're telling me that you can't move the natural frequency up or down. So if this is what you're saying, you can't raise or lower the natural frequency, are you then saying that there's nothing that can be done here?
Well, you see, Seth, that's precisely what makes VFDs so challenging, especially given the limitations of the motor design that we just discussed. But we're not entirely out of options. We just need to be a bit more creative. One solution would be to modify the design to shift offending natural frequencies to a speed range where the end user is less likely to operate. Then that speed can be blocked out on the VFD so that the pump doesn't operate there. So you see, it's not quite so simple, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's... I've seen this option before, and I don't think really anyone really likes it. It does describe that this engineering analysis and the subsequent remediation still costs a whole lot less than a complete new pump. That's all it for vibration and the discussion today. I wanted to recap some of the topics that we talked about today. So first I want to thank Elvis and Bob, and thank you to Dan and Marcus for taking the time today to discuss with us vertical pump engineering. So today we talked about hydraulic design for a reliable vertical pump, and also we talked about the structural vibration effects on this style of pump. Some of the key takeaways from today is, you know, make sure to understand that the asset, you know, how it works from the operator's perspective, how its intended use is going to be, including excursions. You know, don't trust that the data sheet will provide all the knowledge necessary for success and challenge any original installation with today's know-how and technology. Another thing, engineering analysis tools, you know, we keep growing and keep getting better at using them. They can give you an opportunity for increased flow or increased pressures and improved reliability. So this is beyond that design by analysis rules that you see in standards. Now, book curves are for bowl assemblies, not for the complete pump unit. The final performance for vertically, you know, suspended pumps will be less than these standardized curves. And incorporating a VFD can be, you know, is an application, it's going to be to an application, adds risk, right? So to do so, that means you're going to have add risk to critical vibration failure modes. So communicate and verify with a qualified pump expert before you buy that VFD. And also, you know, changes to the motor may affect the natural frequency to the pump system as well. Again, contact that qualified pump expert. The last thing I wanted to bring up, you know, is that detuning and other vibration mitigation actions may affect the hydraulic performance, or it may affect and create high vibration in another pump component or system of components, right? So again, verify this through the pump expert as well. I certainly want to sincerely thank everyone for listening today. There's plenty to be discussed with respect to vertically suspended pumps and the technology surrounding them. I hope you enjoyed and maybe learned a little bit from this webcast. If you have any questions regarding vertical pump reliability and design, please take a moment to contact Dave Clark or myself, and we'd be delighted to, you know, communicate with you further. A replay of this webinar will also be available soon on pumpsandsystems.com. For those of you listening to the replay, you're welcome. Please contact either Dave Clark or myself, Seth Tate, to get your questions answered as well. Lastly, you know, a big thanks again to Pumps and Systems for an outstanding platform and an opportunity to connect with you guys today. At this time, I'd like to hand back control to the moderator with Pumps and Systems and open up for questions.
Thank you, Seth. That was great, and our participants are really engaged, and there are a lot of questions. So let's just get started. The first one, I noticed we didn't get a chance to talk about composite bearings and closing tubes and such. Will you have another webinar like this around that, those topics?
Well, this is Seth. I'd like to answer that and just say, it would be great if you guys had a moment to say what you want to know, what you want to learn about these things. Please, Dave Clark, myself, send us an email. We'd love to know what more information you'd like to see and like to know. So,
additionally, if ideas for webinars in the chat feature would be great. We are always looking for topics, and we use those for articles, too, in the magazine. So we'd always love to hear from you, but have the chat feature in front of you today, which is pretty cool. Okay, Seth, what are common solutions to move the natural frequency away from the running speed on pumps that are already installed?
That definitely sounds like an Elvis question.
Yeah, that is really a good question, and one that, you know, tends to come up, especially if you can't design a pump as a from a new equipment standpoint. So in general, detuning modes to resolve resonance requires modification of either the structure's mass, its stiffness, the system damping that's present, or a combination of these. And in the case of vertical pumps, system damping is not really significant. But if you have equipment that's already installed in the field, then our options are typically limited, and, you know, one can't change the pipe thickness, for example. So some of these options would be things like welding ribs to stiffen the design and raise its natural frequency, or you could also attach blocks of mass in order to lower its natural frequency. You could open up and enlarge the window opening on the motor support structure. You could install a detuning device known as a spring plate, which typically goes between the motor and the support structure, again, in order to lower its natural frequency. And in cases where, you know, you run out of options, you can even look at making use of dynamic absorbers, which are one degree of freedom spring mass systems, and they're usually designed, tuned, and installed in series with the pump in order to mitigate vibration. And of course, if you are operating a particular pump that's already installed on a VFD, then you could look at blocking out the offending range in that VFD in order to allow it to operate safely. And I would like to emphasize that in general, if you make any of these modifications, it's really necessary that they be verified with a finite element analysis prior to implementation. Otherwise, you run the risk of, you know, spending the time and having costly solutions that prove unsuccessful once they've been implemented, and not to mention some of the changes like enlarging a motor support's window opening is a change that's really irreversible. Back to you, Alicia.
Okay, great. We know that bearings are critical to pump operations. There are a couple questions around bearings. Where would they take the vibration reading from beside the bearing houses? It could be from besides the bearing houses, but vibration.
Yeah,
around
so
here.
That's.
Okay, go ahead, Elvis.
Yes, Ed, let me take this one. So, yeah, so this is actually a very another important topic to discuss, and typically because vibration readings on vertical pumps, more often than not, we find that they're being taken at the top of the motor. However, standards like API 610 and HI and practically any other standard I've come across defines vibration limits to be taken at the mounting flange of the motor. So the base of the motor, not the top of the motor, which is where it's typically taken. So really, the answer to this question is that vibration measurements, you know, for any machine really should be taken at the location defined by the standard that specifies the acceptable limits for that vibration. And in the case of vertical pumps, this is typically at the mounting flange of the motor. Sorry, Alicia, back to you.
Hey, there. Okay, someone's asking about material selection. And how you work with that, to just elaborate more about that and how it relates to any totes that should be referenced, like with HI or whatever.
So material selection, and if I rephrase this correctly, then how do we select the right materials, and how does that connect to what standards are involved? Does that sound about right?
Yes.
This is Bob Davis, and I can handle that question if you'd like me to. API has a list of categories of liquids being pumped and the materials that are suitable for that liquid being pumped. And so I use API's chart. This is in API 610 booklet, and it gives a list of the materials and the liquids being handled there. And I use that. Also, Sulzer has a program that we can feed in the different analysis of the liquid. In other words, the amount of sulfur, the amount of chlorine, the other components, and it will give us a generic selection for materials. And then a lot of it is just experience that Sulzer has had over the years pumping many, many different types of liquids, and our experience on what we find that will work the best with this. Lisa?
So if I elaborate back on what you're saying, Bob, then you kind of start with the design by role, which is what's in API 610 or in the standards. But those standards, again, can go beyond that. There's more technologies out there than those standards are going to provide knowledge to. And Sulzer, how we kind of bring that to the table is both with going beyond with our own internal software and internal knowledge, as well as the expertise and experience of the people that we involve in, say, that retrofit or that new application. So if we're getting involved with certain composites, for instance, we may actually also call on the experts of these composites, not only within Sulzer, but we may actually call on the manufacturer of the composite to really talk about, and kind of like we talked about today, really talk about those excursions, those things beyond what's in the data sheet, and knowing that stuff is very important and being successful with the installation.
Yeah, that's correct. I'm sorry, guys. Yeah, if I can add something, and I think that's really important to have, you know, more knowledge we have about the liquid, the media that we're going to pump, better the selection we can do in regards to the material. We have some situations that we select, you know, we work on a retrofit of a pump, and we get the liquid analysis, and then materials were completely wrong due to the analysis of the liquid. So more information we have, better we can select the material, I would say.
All right. Okay, I've got a question here that's directed to Dan. So the person is asking that for vane pass frequency vibration, is there any arrangement in the impellers for vane pass frequency vibration?
Well, yes, the impeller is the source of the vane pass excitation. So if you change the vane count in the impeller, you'll change the excitation frequency. Now, there are going to be some limits as to how much you can change the vane count, because the vane count has a big determination on the resultant hydraulic performance. And the hydraulic performance is a requisite that must be achieved. So within certain limits, yes, we can change the vane count to change the excitation frequency while considering the corresponding effects on the hydraulic performance. Back to you, Alicia.
While we're waiting here, I have a follow-up question for Dan, I guess, here as well. What's the differences in, I guess, the amplitude or how it affects in the reliability, things like that? When a lot of the pumps we're talking about today, they're diffuser-style pumps instead of volute-style pumps. So kind of the difference between vane pass vibration with a diffuser versus a volute. Can you describe that?
Yeah, sure. That does introduce some additional complexities, because there is always the potential for a situation where the combination of the impeller and the diffuser vane count can interact in such a way to, amplify or exaggerate the resulting vane pass excitation. So there are design rules, proprietary design rules, as well as general kind of rules of thumb, if you will, or industry standards when it comes to selecting the combination between the impeller vane count and the bowl vane count, in order that you avoid these combinations that result in sort of amplification, if you will, of the vane pass frequency. Now, as we talked about it during the presentation as well, there are other mitigation strategies that can be employed, and perhaps one of the most common is to adjust the operating clearance between the impeller and the bowl. Now, the larger one can make that operating clearance, the lower frequency, or the lower magnitude of the resultant hydrodynamic excitation. Now, of course, that remediation will always be subject, again, to the necessary hydraulic performance for the machine, because as one increases that clearance, it's usually achieved through either a trim of the impeller, or in some cases, it may be possible to achieve that through some trim of the bowl vanes. But as you do that, you adjust or you affect the resultant hydraulic performance.
Yeah, so what we're doing then is going back to Rob Peter to PayPal. We go and fix the vibration issue, but now we're not able to pump at the rates we were wanting to pump at because we increased that clearance. We kind of talked about that before.
Yeah.
One thing can affect another.
Exactly. Yeah, and this really brings in the need, and as Elvis and Marcus and Bob have stressed throughout the discussion here, is that the overall system must be considered as a whole, both the mechanical constraints and considerations, as well as the fluid dynamic constraints and considerations, and everything needs to be assessed as an integrated system such that, hydraulic performance is met as well as vibration criteria are met.
Okay. I'm back. I'm sorry I had a little technical issue, but I'm here. This question is about bearings again. Do you expect half whirl resonance excitation from the steady bearings?
Yeah, I'll take that one, Alicia. And that's a question that's related to vibration. And I see there's actually another question that's similar to it, where I think it's Brent. He asked about 0.46x vibration, which is just under half x. And this issue is one that's really related to bearing instability in vertical pumps. It's something that's more common with vertical pumps because of the low level of damping. And it has to do with a high cross-coupled stiffness on these plane journal bearings that we have in vertical pumps. So that's really where the issue is coming from. It's an instability mechanism that's just under half x. And typically, one of the ways to kind of address that issue is making a change in the bearing in order to either reduce the cross-coupled stiffness associated with it or to introduce damping. So that's typically how that issue is handled. But it is one that is of concern, and we have determined at Sulzer that it's something that really needs to be looked at, and so it's something that's considered as one of the major excitation mechanisms besides unbalance whenever we perform these analyses. Back to you, Alicia.
So because I don't understand it entirely, Ellis, can you add what are the symptoms of this vibration? What would I see in the field?
So it wouldn't be much different from
the spectrum analysis.
Yeah, so it wouldn't be much different from what you would see with above-grade vibration. The interesting thing about this is that it's primarily below-grade, so it's in the columns, the column and bowl structure, which is typically submerged, or in the case of a can pump, the VS6, you don't see it at all. And it's very uncommon to find that vibration measurements are actually taken there. So it's one of those issues that when it exists in the system, you don't actually see it until, your bearings wear out a lot quicker, your bearings go out a lot quicker. So it's there. It's not you see it typically only when you've had some catastrophic failure or when you go in to do some maintenance on the system and you notice that your bearings are worn out quite a bit quicker than what you would have expected for the life of those bearings. So it's something that at the moment, at least for most purchases, measurements are not really being taken there, so it's hard to tell. In the case of a VS1 where it's just in an open sump, sometimes you can observe that if you have the ability to kind of watch the pump in operation when you look at its below grade, but the amplitude of vibration is not much different than what you would see if you were looking at an above grade that was, you know, swing back and forth excessively.
And so the wiping of these bearings, the low reliability of these bearings, one of the key things I can then do is then have a company like Sulzer come out we need all the data on the equipment to do this analysis, but it's your engineering analysis you spoke of that would actually be able to define what this is and that it's happening, correct?
This is correct. I mean, this is really one of those tough things where you have to, well, from the experience and the studies, we learn about these things. Now, if you did take measurements or if you perform like an impact resonance test when the pump is not operating to determine where the natural frequencies of both the above and below grade components fall, you would typically see this natural frequency around that half X excitation region. It'll show up in your spectra for your impact resonance test. And so that's how you can identify, at least prior to performing any detailed analysis, that there is the potential for a problem that exists associated with those bearings.
Okay, here's another question about natural frequency, about frequency. Could you implement some sort of damping ratio if the pump operates near the natural frequency?
So that's a good question, because damping in the system is one of the ways that you can generally try to detune modes that don't have sufficient separation margin. However, in vertical pumps, it's quite tough. Most of the damping that you have in the system is really existent in the bow assembly, right around the wear rings and such. Even in the bearings, as we just discussed, the damping in the bearings, the line shaft bearings within the column structure are generally very small. So that's really only about the area where you could try to increase damping by, say, reducing your clearances. Again, in the bowl section, reducing the clearances between those bearings, but it won't be very long before the clearances get worn out over the operation of the pump. So generally speaking, on vertical pumps, the target is on the stiffness and the mass of the structure. There's not very much else that can be done in terms of bearing, at least outside of the pump structure system itself, unless you design some other feature, like a passive dynamic absorber, perhaps, that comes with damping, you know, like a damping mechanism to it. That's maybe about the only way that can be addressed. But if you take that route, it would typically be like a damped dynamic absorber and not an undamped dynamic absorber. There are two different types there that you can have. Back to you, Alicia.
I think we have time for one more question. Someone is referring, and it's sort of on the same topic, on slide 54, the speaker suggested stiffening the structure or making it more flexible. What if the motor mass was reduced or the motor height could be reduced? Would that make an impact?
Yes, so affecting the mass of the structure in general will make an impact, but if we stop to think here for a moment about reduction of the motor mass, motor manufacturers in general will always try to design probably to, you know, the minimum mass that they can already afford. So if you're talking about reducing motor mass, any areas on the motor frame itself where you might be able to reduce the motor mass is perhaps something that the motor supplier has already looked at, just from a more cost-effective design. So reduction of motor mass when it comes to trying to affect the natural frequency that way is likely something that's not really feasible. And from a standpoint of reducing the height as well, again, a similar thing is done. If it were a taller motor and they have unnecessary additional mass by way of the motor being taller than it really should be, then it ends up being a not so cost-effective design. So the motor is already designed to be really as short as probably can be and just tall enough in order to fit the internals of the motor itself. So in terms of making any changes on the motor to try to affect that, it's typically the addition of mass. It could also be that the mounting flange of the motor is perhaps redesigned with, say, additional bolting, maybe a thicker flange to try and make that joint between the motor and the support structure of the motor to make that joint there a bit stiffer in order to affect the natural frequency. But there again, that's also something that would require a change on the pump in order to accommodate the change on the motor in the case of, say, increasing the quantity of bolts.
One thing I want to add, Elvis, is, you know, I recall a few installations, a few things in the past where the motor that was there, it's from the 60s and 70s, it's a very old motor, and just keeps getting rebuilt and rebuilt and rebuilt. So this goes back to the capability of looking at today's technology and today's know-how of things. And so there is a big difference in the motor that is designed today versus one that's motor that's designed so far back. And so it will be an option to change your motor mass and motor design. But as we talked about in the slide deck, just changing that may cause other issues. You may have an issue right now, but changing that, that's a big expense. It is worth having that discussion with the pump vibration expert to do some kind of analysis to say, okay, yeah, your new motor, this is going to work well versus you're causing other problems because you changed to this particular new motor.
Yes, Seth, and thanks for reiterating that again. It's important that any of these changes that are made really be evaluated with an analysis to ensure that there aren't any other problems that are being introduced in the process of trying to resolve one. Another thing I would just like to add about motor modifications, a lot of the excitation that comes from the motor in terms of unbalance has to do with the balancing of the motor. So it's very important that the balancing on the motor is to at least the standard grade that was specified, and that is actually one area that can be targeted. So in the way of trying to reduce the force, the unbalanced force that's causing excitation of the system, reduction of the unbalance itself in the motor can bring down that vibration amplitude. So rebalancing the motor is one way that can be used to reduce vibration levels to acceptable limits, like when operating on a VFD, for instance. So you could actually operate in a resonance condition but have vibration amplitudes low enough to where it's not a problem, and that can be achieved by rebalancing.
Okay, y'all, that was so great. And there has been such great participation, and we could probably talk another hour about this with all the questions we have. I'm hoping that Sulzer will answer the questions that are left, and we can post them to the site. And also, we went a little over, so I really thank you for your time, everyone sticking with us. And thank you, Sulzer, for such a great presentation. And just one quick reminder, the presentation will be available at pumpsandsystems.com/webinar next week. And with that, I end today's event.